Thank you. First of all, this talk was actually planned in Russian, but I have decided to take a risk and present it in English, because we have a lot of English-speaking guests here. And if I will occasionally paste some Russian or Ukrainian words, just support me with laughter, or I don't know. So yes, the monads in Ruby is actually a really strange thing, and the motivation for this topic was not I have discovered something in process of my daily work, but I have a passion for functional programming, and I have passion for Haskell specifically for Haskell, and I wanted to see if some concepts from Haskell, from functional programming, could be really applicable in Ruby and shine in Ruby in some cases. And this is my research on that. And first of all, I want to ask, maybe raise some hands, who really knows what the monads are? Or how to apply monads? Okay, two people, two persons, great, three persons. Okay, so then this talk will be even more valuable, because the most of it is dedicated to what monads are. So let's start. I was inspired actually by this tweet of Vyacheslav Yegorov, is the Google employee Haskell people are still writing monad tutorials, and JavaScript people are still explaining prototypal inheritance. And I think that monads are a topic which you need to revisit from time to time, because it's a bit tricky. And if you don't, with anything, if you don't apply it daily, you may forget some details of this concept. And what is it actually? Some versions from Google. Monads are burritos. Some people, they war against burritos fans and state that monads are not burritos. Actually, I don't know why it came, this opinion that monads are burritos. I didn't find anything about burritos when I was researching on monads, so. And yes, another famous statement, that monad is just a monoid in the category of indefinitives. I don't believe that you need to know the category theory to understand what is the monad, and functional people tend to surround themselves with some cloud of mystery, but it's not that hard. Actually, it's not that hard. And it doesn't be hard to understand. But to understand what monads are, we will start from the end. You may have noticed that I like to start from the end. And I will try to explain why the monads exist, in what context they are applicable, for what purpose did this concept was invented. Why? Lazy evaluation is the first example of the context where the monads can be useful. So in languages like Ruby, we have eager evaluation. We don't wait for expressions to be evaluated. Evaluation happens instantly. In functional languages, this is pseudocode, and it mimics F#, I guess. In some way, in the first line, you get the not the array, but the iterator which iterates through natural numbers. The second line, you build a function that uses the simplest algorithm to find out is this number a prime or not. The third line, you get all the primes from all of the numbers sequence, but no actual calculation happens, because it's a lazy definition. And you take the 10th prime, it's also a lazy operation. I think some of you may be familiar with the concept of thunk. Thunk, it's a delayed computation, a computation that may or may not happen in future, and it's up to you to request the result of this computation or to leave it alone. And actually, only the last line is the place where you request this result. When you do some side effect, when you like print something to the console or save it to database, you initiate, you start all of the chain of these computations, but because you take only 10 primes, these iterator numbers will yield you only 10 items. Only 10 items will be checked for other primes or not, and only 10 of them will be printed to the console. You're doing everything lazy, and you do only what you want to do, not just polluting your memory with like infinite sequence of primes and getting your computer. A second example is maybe rather funny, but I think that it's like a funny case of the lazy evaluation, because it's a shortcut evaluation of if expression in Ruby. If the first part of this chain is false, you will never get the second part executed. And I think that future is like a good thing to try to explain monads. Future actually is a concept of the same thunk. The computation will happen in some moment in future, and actually this object, this construct is used for async computations. And actually my future class, I based it on the concurrent Ruby gem, which has the awesome collection of some primitives for this stuff, like concurrency, async computations, and etc. And our future class is very simple. The constructor, it gets a block. The code in the block is executed like a synchronous code. But from the purpose, from the point of view of the observer, it looks like in JavaScript. This block is executed in the another thread. So execution of your main thread continues just from the point where you have created this future. This future has a predicate method called complete, which is non-blocking and allows you to check if the block of the code has completed at any moment of time. And onComplete callback will allow you to have some handler when this execution is accomplished. Value is a blocking operation. When you try to request a value and the block has not completed yet, you will be blocked in the current thread until this block will be executed till its end. I wanted to start from the ugly example, like procedural example. If there are any functional programming fans, you will be highly irritated by this. Because, first of all, we query some service for users, store it in an array, a large array, I guess. Then we query for another types of users. Then we combine those arrays into third array and use the select from enumerable module to select all active users and to get the size of this collection. It is a working code, actually. It could be a working code, but this code has a serious flaw. The user service all query and the HFT user service for last month query, they are blocking. They are synchronous. So you will wait. You will have to wait. And your execution flow will not continue. Before you want to continue, you will have to wait until all of these users are fetched from their remote locations. And this example is much, in my opinion, is much more beautiful and logical structured, because you have like pure functions here, so you can easily predict their execution. You have like natural flow, so you have just described the sequence for execution, And you can forget actually about when it will be accomplished, when it will be executed. You can continue go further into execution flow, and somewhere later those incomplete callbacks will finish, and our futures will return our users. But another tricky part, the concat function and other functions on the top of the calling graph, they need to know how to work with this async execution of the future. So I have marked them with F letter. F letter means that this is a function that knows that its arguments are futures, and its return value is also a future. Because it will be no benefit for this function to return a value. It will again become a blocking function. We don't want blocking. We want a completely async flow execution. So we start from ingredients that actually form a monad. Because I will get to that later, but our future is a monad. Just believe me that it is. The first ingredient is called unit. Our future, as you have noticed, I guess, it's a like container. It wraps the value which will be obtained after the execution of this block. And we will enhance our future with a couple of methods and properties. First is the different constructor initializer. Or it may be parameterized or parameterless, but our future will get a method complete with. You can just pass a value there, and this future will be marked as completed immediately. The value will not block because this future has already completed, and we can define a method. Just like syntactic sugar, I guess, a class-level method called unit, which has the signature. It takes any value and returns a future, which wraps that value. Unit was actually chosen because it's like a standard name for this method in the functional computations theory, and another names for that are bind and return you may encounter when you will like Google for these. The second ingredient is fmap. What is fmap? We will start building our example, which we had here. Just keep it in mind that we are going towards this example to be implemented, and we start from building our count underscore f function, the simplest one. Function that takes a future, and it extracts a value from that future. So we take a future, okay. But for this very function, we get a future that encapsulates enumerable. We need to extract this enumerable to calculate count of elements, and then again wrap this count into a new future to preserve the async flow of execution. And there is a standard instrument for that. It's called fmap. Actually, it's a function which is provided by our view, which will map. It will extract a value from the view, map it to some other value, and after that will box this value into another future. You can see it in this on the second snippet. We build a new future. It's an empty future. It's not started to execute any async code. Then on the incomplete callback of our current future, we will call completion of our new future with the value which was extracted from current future, mapped with function func that we even point. Okay, awesome. So you have our func. Func is the function which we have used here, just mapping the boxed value to some other value. And then we are boxing it again into a future. We complete it immediately, and we return it. Actually, it may be sound very unusual, but array is also a monad. Because array is also a container. It contains some elements. It does have map function. And the result is also an array. And in many like publications on monads, arrays are also compared to monads. Like a controversial thing, but you can refer to it sometime. We continue building our shiny example. The second function is the filter function, which will filter only active users. Actually, it's trivial because it uses the same approach. We use fmap to extract the encapsulated value from future, map it to some other value, and to return it as a new future. And we need to go deeper. We need to chain futures. Why? Actually, when we get back to our example, the hardest thing is concat, because it's actually a function which allows parallel execution of future. It's like a thread join. You execute two threads, you get the results of all of them, and you combine it in some other way. But it's too complex for us to start with a parallel execution of future. We need to understand how execute sequential futures, one after another. It will make us a simpler way to understand how to build the concat. So, chaining futures. We have another example. It's not much related to our initial one. We query for all users. And we want to map them, and how we map? We pick, we take all of the users, we pick first user, and we want to have its profile from any another service. Also wrapping it in the future, and actually because we use our pretty good fmap, we expect that the value of this future is our user profile. But we are wrong, because the value we are getting from this func is a future. We have built a future of a future which encapsulates another future. And this example doesn't work, because you build a new future, you complete it with another future, which is returned from this callback. You return this future, and it's already marked complete. But the internal operation hasn't accomplished yet. You need some mechanism to unwrap, to flatten these futures. When you get a future of a future, you need to compress them and to get single future in return, which actually encapsulates the latest async operation. So we come to flatten. Another name for this is join, especially in Haskell community. How does our flatten work? We create our new flat future. On complete of our current future, we get another future, which is internal future, and we use its on complete callback to accomplish our external flat future. When we are returning our flat future, we get a future which we expect, a future which encapsulates already built and immutable value. So just to revise, we have a unit which encapsulates an immutable value into a future. We have fmap, which helps us extract this value and map it to some other one and encapsulate it into the future again. And we have flatten. Flatten helps us to flatten futures, to get a future of a future to behave well and to be just a simple future of a value. And we came to bind because we don't want to always call fmap flatten fmap flatten. We just have a single function to do it. And it's called bind. It's a value. It takes a future of a value. It takes a function because its argument is a function. I know that it can be like hard, and maybe you can even stop me if you don't understand something. Do you follow me? It's okay? Okay, good. Bind gets a function. First type in this annotation is the parameter of the function. It's a plain value. This is a return value of this function. It's a future. And our function bind returns a future. Just a plain future of a value. So in our previous example, instead of using fmap here or fmap flatten here, we use bind. And then our snippet works as expected. We have user profile as a value of the result in future. Yes, two important things. Future is monad. As I said, just believe me. You will understand why a bit later. And the second, I won't tell you how the concat function is built, but because it will take too much time. But I can give you some clues. The concept of lifting. Lifting of functions. What is lifting? We had a plain function count, which takes enumerable. We have lifted it, and now it can take a future, which holds an enumerable. And we lift a function lifts a function of single argument. Count receives a single argument. We can build a function lift two, which can lift functions of two arguments. It's very easy. So it will take concat. Concat knows how to concatenate two arrays. And after lifting, you will get the concat f, who will take two futures. A future of array and the future of another array. And its output will be a future of concatenated array. And I encourage you to like Google for these things, for the concept of lifting, for the lift2 function. It's also called liftm2 in Haskell community. And it will be pretty easy for you to understand. And at last, as I said, let's start from an end. And in the beginning, we will come to the definition. Monad is a data type. Monad is a box around a value. It's a container for some immutable value or just a value. It has a unit operation, which wraps a value inside of the monad. It has a bind operation, which allows you to build a chain of transformations over a monadic value. An important part thing that it's a monadic value, because not a just a mutable value or plain value. And you may encounter a definition like programmable semicolon for monads. Why is that? Because actually monad allows you to chain. We have just seen that it allows you to chain computations. You get some async computation. You want to chain it with another computation, and with another, and with another, and you may define in your own code how will you chain this. Maybe up to this moment you were wondering why I am listening to this, how it can be useful. But let's take an example, like a business transaction. A huge controller. When you get params from browser, you need to check a lot of conditions like does user have enough money on its account? Does this shipment service is okay and responds 200, etc., etc. And you build the execution flow. It may be potentially an async execution flow. And Monad is a tool that provides you with some convenient, and later you will, I guess I will convince you that they are convenient means of building some execution flows, some asynchronous execution. The first and the most famous example is a maybe monad. I believe that most of you have heard about it. It's also called option type. Maybe monad represents a value that may be present or may be not. It may be nil or it may be actual value. I wrote that simple maybe class. It's very ugly, and people from like dry monads, dry RB team made it better, and we will get to it a bit later, but still it does its job. You have two types of values when you speak about maybe. You have sum, which will be initialized with some value, and you will have none. Actually, none is sum where nil is passed as a value. Because maybe is a monad, we define our standard methods for it, standard operations. Unit function, for like syntax sugar, I have decided to make it like an index operator. And if the value is nil, we return none. If we have some value, we return sum. So it's very simple. And the bind function is the key to the maybe monad. If we don't have a value, if our value is none, we return self. We just return ourselves. And if we have some value inside, we pass it to another monad, which will get from the func. As you must remember, func takes our value, which is extracted for our monad, packs it in another maybe monad, and just go on. And the example of usage of this monad. You want to add two integers, but you don't know if they're actually integers or nils. These two values, I won't use the value word. These two arguments are monads. They are not values. They are monads. And this function is monadic function because it takes monads. We take first monad. We use its bind to extract its value into x. And we, while we are inside this callback, we don't know if x is a nil or is it a real number. Calling bind, value of m1 unpacked to x. We need to return maybe monad from this callback. M2 is maybe monad, okay, and its bind method will also return maybe by definition. So we are okay with our return value type. And you just remember that x is in the scope, the actual value of the monad. We don't know is it a nil or a value of any or an integer value. We call bind for M2. The same thing. Value of M2 is unpacked to Y, to Y variable. And in the end, we pack the result of the addition of X and Y into maybe monads. And why I have written that X and Y are integers. Let's go back. Let's go back and see the definition of bind function. If we are none, let's return self. Let's not call bind at all. So when we call bind here, and when this callback is executed, actually, I was a bit tricking you. We sure that x is a value. We are sure 100% that x is an integer value here. Otherwise, the bind would not get called at all, by definition. And we are when we are in this callback, we are 100% sure that y is a second integer, because otherwise, this callback wouldn't get called at all. So when you have maybe monad, you have a programmable semicolon. You define whether you want to break the execution chain or whether you want to continue the execution. The maybe monad is a primary tool when you don't know you have nil values or you have real values. You can build the whole execution flow on your maybe monad, and you will not get nil error or like no method error for nil class ever. Because your execution flow will be interrupted at any point where you have none, and because the return value of your execution flow is maybe monad, you are safe. You will not get any of these exceptions. Some examples. Adding two monads with valid integer values is sum. Extracting the value is just a plain integer. And this value is none because sum of the actual values was nil. And the, as I have said about the previous example, the bind is not even get called for a second maybe. Most of the further examples are from the awesome gem dry monads. The dry RB team, which actually a group of people which works on ROM RB as well, they have prepared the awesome collection of monads, and I will get back later to another implementations of monads in Ruby community. But their code is like the most understandable, I guess, on how you can apply monads in real Ruby production code. So here you have a user which is wrapped into a maybe. If the user is not nil, you will get this callback called. If its address not nil, you will get the internal callback called, and you will get its street wrapped into a maybe. And you will get, you can get a nil here, but you will be safe because it's wrapped in maybe. So it's a very simple example. Okay, maybe is not the only monad. Monads actually have some standard, like there are some standard monads, which I have found themselves useful in the functional programming. The either monad. The either monad is very similar to maybe. It may execute successfully, or it may return an error. And use the either monad where when you need the value of the error. It's a simple calculator which calculates only if value is greater than 1 and is divisible by 2. Have you seen this diagram? Are you familiar with this talk? Railway-oriented programming. Anyone? Maybe raise some hands. Oh, okay, good. So this is actually an example of railway-oriented programming. If we are good, we continue to the next steps. If we are not good, we fail fast, and we break execution flow. We don't execute any further steps. Try monad. Monad try, because Ruby was not designed for this kind of flow. And we may encounter exceptions, which will break our execution flow, but not in the way we want to. And we need to catch those exceptions, some of them at least. And the try monad does this very job. It catches exceptions. It catches exceptions and it wraps them into a monad, and you are able to get them just like an exception class instance from the exception attribute. And others. There are other monads, list, continuation, and maybe others. And these are way too complex to explain in such a short period of time. But I think that the most useful ones are here, the try, the either, and maybe monads, because they allow you to build a like to use the term data flow-oriented programming. When you completely define the flow, how your data moves inside your code, and you have no surprises like non-local jumps, oh, I get an exception, let's jump somewhere else, you are 100% sure that in the end you will get some value. Some value, and you can inspect it, and you can understand is my computation successful or it has failed at some step. And you can use the either monad to encapsulate this failure. You may get it in the end. And to understand why did okay, so some implementations of monads in Ruby. Actually, there are not so many. The first, historically first, I guess, was the monadic gem from some individual contributor, individual developer. Unfortunately, I don't remember his name, but it was like maybe the first repository on GitHub, which was implementation of monads. It was working, it was covered with tests, but unfortunately it's abandoned, it's not supported anymore. Because its author decided to move further to a new gem, he has named it deterministic. The set of the supported monads has grown larger, and but at some point maybe the author has lost its interest, he stopped supporting. The monads gem. This gem is very useful, like for a novice, for a beginner, to grasp into the monads concept, because it was made for a talk, and there are three monads there: maybe, list, and continuation. And it's a very that simple example of how these monads work. And I highly recommend this repository for anyone that want to improve understanding monads. Precisely. Functional people tend to know to name, their repositories in the mysterious ways. Precisely is actually the last name of a physicist, but a mathematician, a Swiss mathematician, and it's a term of category theory called Precisely category. I don't know what it means actually, but it's very funny. And yes, there were two guys that decided to build this gem, and they built it. I think it was the most like awesome, the most highly documented, easy to use implementation of all of these monads. Even functional composition operators, which you can find only in like pure functional languages, they have implemented it. And actually, the Precisely gem was an inspiration for dry monads. And I guess a lot of some code pieces were just integrated in dry monads. Dry monads has a very good documentation. It has a good commits rate. Even in this, even this month, there were some commits fixing some bugs, adding some improvements, etc. And I think we can trust this team because, as I have already said, it's the same which is behind the Romer B. And actually, dry monads are used by another gem called Dry Transaction. Dry Transaction is encouraged to be used for every person who uses Romer B. Dry Transaction is a standard way to encapsulate a business transaction, multi-step, which can fail at any point. And actually, Dry Transactions uses the same either monad. So some honorable mentions. Solid use case is a very ancient gem, actually. I don't believe it's widely used now, but this very gem was used as an example for this talk, railway-oriented programming. So if you want, if you don't want to dive into dry monads or dry transactions, you can try solid use case in your project when you need to define some complex business transaction. And you want to be sure that it won't like clutter your code with a lot of ifs, switches, etc. And you can always write your own implementation of it. It's not so hard as you have just seen in this presentation. Thank you for your attention. Any questions? Actually, it's a good one, but I think that we are defined in real life by the projects that we work on. We're defined by the teams. So I have dreams in some day that I will switch to Haskell or switch to Elixir. And actually, it's not that hard nowadays to switch Elixir. But in our current projects, we have to use Ruby, and we have to convince our team at least to use some advanced stuff. So this is the answer. Just we are limited by our current platform. Current.
And second one, do you use it in production in your project right now?
No, honestly, no.
Okay.
My question about chain of results of monads. So how do you think which size of chains is good to have? Because you can have a lot of actions, for example 5, 10, 20, and every time you need to bind, and you have some deep stack, and this is very hard to review. So what do you think about this?
I think it's not hard from the purpose of the execution stack, but as you have said, from the observation perspective, from the code review perspective, general understanding. And actually, I thought of including additional slides in this presentation with examples from some other programming languages. The most hard issue here is syntax. In Ruby, we don't have convenient syntax for this chain. But in other languages like F-sharp, Haskell, they do have very convenient syntax. And maybe you have heard of pipeline operator in Elixir. Very similar. It's very similar. You just chain not the return values of methods, but you chain monadic values. And looks the same, almost the same as pipeline. And very easy to read. Any other questions?
I have a question. It's a bit abstract about functional programming. So for me, for a person who don't really knowledgeable about functional programming, this monad where it looks like a new pattern, new object patterns. So from your opinion, can learning functional programming give some insights about how to make
Yes, I think learning functional programming may help because there are some concepts from it that we can daily use in our object-oriented code. I mean data immutability, I mean pure functions at least. Because even in like non-pure languages like Ruby, it helps to improve the code readability. It helps to improve the adherence to SRP, single responsibility principle, and it may help. And actually, I think just learning functional programming will extend your capabilities of your mind, because learning this is really hard. I spent like 5 hours reading the same article on functors, monads, fmaps, etc. I was reading it again and again, paragraph after paragraph, until I was able to fully understand. It will just empower you with some additional learning capabilities, solving capabilities.
Does it make sense to use monads in Ruby without types?
Excuse me.
I mean, you don't have types in Ruby. Mm-hmm. Does it make sense to try to use monads?
Yes, I think it may help or it can be useful because monads are actually not limited to have or not having types. Monads are for building execution flows. So when we talk about types, the most useful outcome of having types is for languages which allow compilation. You can catch the errors at the compilation. And monads, typing is not required for monads, because monads is more about chaining. Monads is about composing the execution. So I think it's not impossible monads without types information dynamically typed.
Okay. What about pattern matching with types? You don't have these guarantees from the monads. Like you cover all the either cases. So it doesn't really look like it makes sense.
So you are trying to say that pattern matching is a better mechanism than either.
I understand that without types, you don't have guarantee from the compiler style mm-hmm. checker that you covered all the cases of, for example, many mode, mm-hmm. optionals, just and not mm-hmm. case. So, in reality, it means that your code isn't really better. You don't have better execution flow because you don't have these guarantees.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I see
you stay with the same concept. You're just writing the functions a bit differently.
I see your point. From my point of view, it's just my personal opinion. When I was like looking in try monad, this thought came into my mind that you find the executable and you build some contract around what exceptions and what execution flow branches do you expect from your program. Any derivation, any other way, any unexpected exception is an error. We should treat it like a compile time error in the compile language. For instance, we can have different types of we have types of exceptions which we want to handle, and types of exceptions that we don't want to handle. Appearing like zero division error signals almost always that something is wrong with our code. It was a programmer error. It has to be fixed at programming level or in the compiled language for the compiler. So I think that we may build a flow here when we define the happy path. And all of the other unhappy path, we consider them invalid to execute. We may just restart the worker, or we may just look into the honey badger and say, oh, okay, this must be fixed. Because it was not expected.
I see what you mean. In my opinion, it doesn't really make sense.
what is your suggestion?
You don't get really anything on this. If you miss one point, the case of nothing in any moment. You don't really get any value from the monads because all monads in chain doesn't make sense because you missed only one point in this case. So you don't have anything to guarantee that you don't miss this stuff. You don't have compiler, you don't have static analyzer. Maybe if you have cotomorphism, you can try to force to pass two blocks.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. But still, it doesn't really sound like you can get something before you execute your code. And I think that's the case. There's moments exactly. You have to have these guarantees beforehand.
Yes, but unfortunately, we don't have these guarantees.
Yes.
So
I think it's more up to language, more up to language infrastructure.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, that's it. Thank you.